Listening Library presents The Explorers, The Reckless Rescue by Adrienne Kress. Read for you by Kristen Sieh. To readers, who are the ultimate explorers. Frustrating. But you know what's even worse than a cliffhanger? Waiting to hear what happens, then finally getting your hands on the next book, and the author decides to begin the story with a character you've never met, doing something in a place you've barely heard of. That's totally the worst. Benedict sat staring at the vista before him. The whole world was laid bare. Vulnerable, it seemed, sprawling from the base of the active volcano he was sitting high atop. Which he had to admit, it was. Vulnerable. Though in such a peaceful moment, it felt highly absurd to picture flows of lava, clouds of black ash, or anything violent, really. The sun was setting over the sea in the distance, and there wasn't a single cloud in the sky. The birds were calmly chatting to each other, having gotten over the unfortunate misunderstanding from that morning. From this vantage point, he could almost imagine he was the only human on Earth. The town that he knew lay beneath him was masked from view by lush green foliage. He had given himself 2 months, a short leave that even the university had suggested be extended because of some kind of affection for him, or maybe because 2 months really messed with their scheduling. But he hadn't wanted more. He had just needed some space, a little room to clear his head. And he'd been wanting to photograph the isolated, vertiginous volcano for years. Yet 6 weeks had already passed and he hadn't taken a single picture. Sure, he'd looked through the scope, he'd set up shots, he'd paced back and forth, but pressing down his finger, hearing that satisfying click, there was something that was preventing him. He let go of his camera, letting it dangle from his neck on its strap, and stared at his hands. It was surprising that in such a humid climate they could be so cracked. But days spent climbing up and down the side of a volcano had worn away at his palms, and the wind at this height had dried out his skin. He balled his right hand into a fist and squeezed it with his left until he heard and felt the pleasing pop of his knuckles. Then he pulled up the collar of his green windbreaker and buffered his neck against the sharp wind. Not one single photograph. Why? What was he waiting for? Mr. Barnes? Asked a warm, happy voice, slowly, haltingly.
Why so hesitant, Peter? Asked Benedict, turning to the young man.
Peter grinned and sat beside him. Benedict smiled back. He had met Peter on his first day in the town. The local teenager was fascinated with photography, had started a club at his school, and had wanted to be Benedict's apprentice. Benedict wasn't comfortable with the term. There wasn't much he could offer the boy. He liked to work alone. But he'd allowed Peter to follow him a few times, to watch. Right now, evidently, to stare.
Was there something you wanted? Asked Benedict.
Oh, yes. This came for you.
Peter reached into his pocket and pulled out a letter.
A letter?
Benedict was charmed. He couldn't think of the last time someone had written him a letter. He took it from Peter and looked at it. Urgent was handwritten in red across the front, and it had been sent to the university. He supposed they had decided to forward it to him, despite his request that they not do that with his mail, mostly because all he got were bills and magazines, nothing he wanted to deal with on top of a volcano. Urgent. He flipped it over. A red wax blob sealed the letter closed. Stamped onto it was an unusual-looking symbol. Benedict furrowed his brow. Then he shoved the letter into his pocket.
You're not going to read it? Asked Peter.
Benedict gazed out at the setting sun bleeding over the landscape.
Not today, Peter.
He cracked the knuckles on his right hand again.
Not today.
Chapter 1, in which we resume our story. There is a difference between fact and opinion.
It's hard to tell sometimes because opinions like to dress up as facts, and their costumes have gotten quite impressive lately. I once saw an opinion wearing the most spectacular curly mustache that distracted me so much I totally let him come into my head, even though I found his footwear suspicious. There is a way, however, to easily tell the difference between them. You have to weigh them. Because, you see, facts have more substance, so they're heavier. This is how one can know for a fact, for example, that being kidnapped for your brain is scary. Because when this fact is placed on the scale, man, does it ever tip the balance. There are other facts one can be certain of, like that private planes are cool, that traveling long distances gets boring, and that not knowing where you are going or what's going to happen to you is exhaustingly stressful. And if you don't believe me, just ask Sebastian, who was sitting in his seat and staring out the window of the private jet, feeling precisely all those things. It was odd to feel bored. Not that feeling bored is a rare or weird feeling. It's a very common part of life, after all. But it just felt so strange to feel bored in his particular situation. He should have been feeling terrified, possibly even a little excited. And he knew this because he'd felt those things initially when he'd been snatched out of the Explorers Society headquarters and held captive in a helicopter. But that felt like forever ago now. After flying to the private airport, getting on the private plane, flying over the ocean, and continuing to fly over the ocean, and yet more flying over the ocean. Things had started to get just a little boring. And now the boredom was turning into sleepiness, which was really quite simply all kinds of wrong.
"You could sleep," said Mr. M.
Sebastian shifted his gaze from the window to the man sitting across from him wearing a patch over his left eye. Mr. M appeared very relaxed, but of course he would be. His life wasn't in danger now, was it?
"So could you," Sebastian pointed out.
"Nah, gotta keep one eye open,"
replied Mr. M, laughing at his own joke. Sebastian didn't laugh.
"Get it? One eye? Get it?"
Sebastian got it. He just didn't find it particularly funny. Suddenly he had a flash of his parents at the dinner table, and his mother telling that joke about the salamander, and how not funny the joke was, and, oh, there was that pain in his gut again. He wondered if his parents were looking for him. They must be. He wondered if Evie was looking for him, like she'd promised.
"It's because I only have one eye. That's the joke," continued Mr. M. "Because keeping one eye open is an expression." He paused. "But also, I only have one eye. It works on two levels."
"I get the joke," snapped Sebastian in exasperation.
"Whoa, okay, okay. Jeez, relax."
"Easy for you to say," muttered Sebastian under his breath.
"It's true. It's very easy for me to say. I've completed my task. I have the key, which is you."
He stared at Sebastian for a moment, and then, as if by way of explanation,
"You're the key."
"I know I'm the key," Sebastian replied curtly. What on earth was going on? Before this week, everyone had always treated him like the highly intelligent boy he was. Now everyone seemed to be second-guessing his smarts, and it was seriously annoying.
"So anyway, with my job well done, I feel as cool as a cucumber." Mr. M paused. "Why do they say that? Are cucumbers cooler than other vegetables?"
"I don't know why they say that." Another wave of sleepiness was washing over Sebastian. He was tired of dealing with Mr. M, who had this frustrating ability to be both extraordinarily terrifying and completely tedious at the same time. And weirder still, if he hadn't known any better, Sebastian would have sworn that Mr. M wanted to be his friend. Not that there was anything wrong with friends, of course. It's just that people who want to hurt you are not the best choice for friends. Unless, of course, you're part of the "We Want to Hurt Each Other for Fun" club, which, from my understanding, is currently down to one member. Just as Sebastian finally gave in to his exhaustion and closed his eyes, he was rudely drawn back to the horror of his situation by a guttural grunt. He started and looked up. Mr. I.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.